want to start with a question that might seem a bit strange, but it's not that strange if you think about it. Why are socialists constantly talking about workers, the working class, the workplace? For a lot of people, getting out of the workplace and doing other things is often what they want to do, but yet when we call ourselves a Socialist Workers' Party, the newspaper, a Socialist Worker, if you read Socialist Worker, it has endless reports about what's happening in this workplace, this union branch, and so on. It seems like we're a bit obsessed with it. I just want to spend 3 or 4 minutes explaining why that is for comrades who that might not be that obvious. And it comes down to the fact that what's the defining characteristic of capitalism, the system of society that we live in? And that's a fundamental division between one group of people, broadly speaking, we'll label them the ruling class, who own or control all of what Marxists call the means of production. They control the offices, factories, the workplace. Workers have no control over those. On the other hand, the vast majority of us have no choice in order to survive but to sell our ability to work in one way or another to those people who control. You've got to hire yourself to some employer in order to live. Of course, there are lots of other divisions in society, lots of other layers, pensioners, students, and so on. All of those are fantastically important. But at the centre of what makes capitalism the system that it is that relationship between that group of people who own and control all of the things necessary to make society function and the people who have to sell their ability to work and go to work in those places. That's what makes capitalism the system that we know. And everything else in society is shaped and defined by that. And in particular, if we want to change society to a different type of society, that's impossible without wresting control of those workplaces, the things necessary to produce the goods, to produce the services that we all depend on to make life possible. Unless we wrest control of those and the people who control them now, it's simply not plausible to talk about a radical transformation of society without addressing that central question. We can change all sorts of other things by protest movements and so on, but ultimately, if we want a different world, we want to have to take control away from those people and put it in the hands of the people who actually do the work in those workplaces. And that's why the real power to transform society fundamentally always comes back to that battle in the workplace for control. We can't talk about socialism unless we want to win that battle in the workplace. And that's why for socialists, of course, we talk about lots of other things, but ultimately we always come back to the question of the workplace and that battle between the working class on the one hand and the ruling class on the other. The second thing is that flows from that is because when you're at work in a workplace, as an individual, you have virtually no power whatever. You might have some limited autonomy in your ability in your own job, but fundamentally, if you want to change anything in that workplace, in particular if you want to challenge the control and power of the people who control it at the moment, that can only be done collectively by people organising together. As an individual against the boss, you have no power. Collectively, you begin to have some possibility of power. There's an old story in trade union circles, you know, one stick is easily broken. You put a bundle of sticks together, it has strength and you can't easily break it. So the question of collective organisation in the workplace is central. And therefore being active in a way that strengthens that collective organisation is fundamental for all socialists. And the basic organisation that gives us collective strength in the workplace is the trade union branch, the organisation of workers in the union. Now, of course, most of the time, trade unions are not about transforming society. You know, if you go in, anybody who's been active in a union, you don't spend your daily activity as a trade unionist talking about the radical overthrow of capitalism, building a new socialist society. Trust me, try it. If that's what you try and do, you're not going to get very far. It's important to raise those arguments, but the daily bread and butter you do in a workplace is actually fighting to improve people's conditions within capitalism. And that's one of the contradictory things about trade unions. They express a desire for things to be different, to be better than they are now, so there's a desire for change from workers, that we're not happy with the way things are at the moment, but they tend to do that within the limits of capitalism. They're about improving and changing capitalism rather than overthrowing it. But nevertheless, Marx and Engels argue, the phrase they use, they're schools of socialism, because it's only through that battle inside capitalism that workers can begin to discover that collective power, that collective strength, that they do have the ability to change the world, and it's out of that the possibility of much bigger changes can grow. It's not the immediate struggle always on the agenda, but it's the basis, the school within which workers can discover their capacity to even begin to think about changing the world. struggles, to bridge between the immediate trade union struggles to change within capitalism and raising the possibility of a much greater transformation. They're not the same thing, but there is a connection and a bridge between the two. But there are lots of other people who aren't revolutionary socialists who also agree that trade unions are important. Lots of workers who are by no means socialists see the need for strong, active unions. I grew up in the mining villages in Durham many, many years ago, and there, it was a very, very powerful trade union culture in the villages, the mining villages where I grew up. I'll tell you a secret, there weren't many of those people who saw themselves as socialists, still less revolutionary socialists. It actually was quite conservative, looked at, dominated by the Catholic Church and so on, but there was an incredibly powerful attachment to the idea that the union makes us strong, it's only the union that can improve our lives. But the word by no means socialist, all sorts of it, mostly attached to the Labour Party and so on. Very few of those people saw themselves as the kind of politics that we have. So there are lots of people who identify the need to have strong unions under capitalism and those to be active and to win changes. But there is something distinctive about our approach to work in unions and in the workplace. And I want to describe what that distinctive approach that we have, as opposed to lots of other people, may be. And it comes back to something that Marx argued, and he used the phrase, the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class, must be the act of the working class. What does that actually mean? It means fundamentally, if we want to talk about creating a different world, no one can do it for us. It's not possible to talk about creating a different world by saying we look to some MPs, some elected government, still less by looking to some union leader. Socialism, if it's going to be possible at all, is about ordinary people at the bottom of society who go to work every day doing it for themselves. We can't have substitutionism, as a word that sometimes is used. You can't look to somebody to do it for you. It's got to come from below and be about us doing it for ourselves. Any vision of a democratic socialist society is fundamentally about that idea of mass democracy from below, ordinary people taking control of their own lives, not waiting for somebody above, however well-intentioned and so on, to do it for us. And that means for us, as socialists, that informs how we operate at work and informs how we operate in the trade unions. It's always about seeking to increase the level of self-activity of work. It's not about some superhero, some great activist, some great leader doing it for people. The litmus test, the thing we should judge all our activity by, is does it increase the level of self-confidence and self-activity of the mass of ordinary people who we work with? However conservative, however far from socialist politics some of those workmates might seem at the moment, getting them to do something is always the thing that we have to come back to. It's not about what you as a union activist do, how great you are. That's nothing. What matters is, did you get somebody else to do it? Did you increase their confidence, their level of self-activity? It's not about, oh, you feel great because you did something against management. That's worth very little. What matters is, do your workmates think they've grown in stature, that they've grown in confidence? And that's a small point, but it's a central point to keep coming back to. Now, of course, the details of how we operate our workplace vary enormously. There's an enormous difference between a well-organised, hard-working education in a school. Lots of schools have virtually 100% trade union membership, and there's a world of difference between operating in that, where we have all sorts of agreements, facilities, recognition, and so on, and where you're working, say, in an unorganised industry. I was talking a little while ago to some comrades who work in bars in Glasgow. No tradition there of organisation, very difficult to organise, yet they have managed to organise. I don't know if any of them are here, if they speak, it's a very useful story. There's a complete difference between how you operate in terms of the details. I've tried to sketch some of those approaches in the pamphlet, and I'm sure the community could add lots of detail and stories to that. And at the end of the day, if you want to be successful at operating at work or in a workplace, there is no substitute for sitting down, talking to your workmates, talking to other people, and discussing through all of those details. There is no magic recipe, no formula you can simply apply. You have to sit down and say, well, what are we going to do here? What can we do? What are the possibilities? And talk through the details, that old method of face-to-face discussion, arguments sometimes, and then agreeing on what you want to do. That's always good. We've got to come back to that. So all I want to do in this meeting, I want to try and keep it quite short, because I think it'll be really interesting for people to talk about their experiences, the problems that they've got, and see if we can tease out some of those. I'm just going to give, if you like, 10 points that seem to be important to always bear in mind wherever you're operating, and then the problem, of course, is then how to apply those in practice, and maybe that's something that we can focus on. So let me try and go through some of those. These will be in shorthand, and obviously, you know, some of them are slightly tongue-in-cheek. So the first thing, what's the most important tools in an activist at workplace? And I'm going to say two things, shoe leather and ears. And what do I mean by that? The first and most important thing is you cannot be an effective union activist unless you wear out lots of shoe leather. What's that mean? It means that you have to go around on a regular and systematic basis and actually talk to all the people you work with. And I underline the word all. Too often what happens is people find like-minded people, the three good union activists or the three or four people who agree with you politically, and they spend their time relating to them. There's nothing wrong with that, and you need to do that. That's not the basis of building effective organisation. What I do, I have a little rule in my school. I have a list of all of the members, and each month, if I haven't had a conversation with every one of those members, I think, hang on, that's a problem. It might be a 10-minute conversation, it might be an hour conversation, it might be a 2-minute conversation, but I just go through and tick, have I actually had a conversation with every single person? There's 57 union members in my workplace, and at least once a month, I want to speak to all of them. Now, that seems a simple thing, but I think it's an indispensable thing in any workplace. Now, obviously, if you're in a massive, great workplace with 1,000 people, you can't do it like that. But the method, in whatever area or section you might be working in, don't ignore anybody. Go around regularly and systematically and have conversations with people, talk to people, to wear out the shoe leather. Don't just sit in your little area talking to the people around you, but make a point of, I haven't spoken to Jim over there, or Mary over there, or Ahmed over there for a couple of weeks. I'm going to have a go and talk to them. And ears. Obviously, a lot of the time, you're going around talking about things you want to raise, but part of that, always end the conversation or give them the opportunity, other things that you're concerned about, issues that you've got, and listen, and you know, don't just talk at people. You might well want to go around and raise solidarity with another strike or something, but if that's all you do and you don't listen to, well, what is it that you're worried about? What are the things that are bothering you at work? What do you need addressing in your section? Let's talk about what we can do and gather in that information. You've got to have the ears to listen to people. So shoe leather and ears. And secondly, I'll come back to that. The second thing I think is important is the idea of, come back to what I said about collective organisation. And what does that mean? It's not about you as a union activist or a rep going around talking to people, listening to people, and then saying, I'll sort it out. The model that you're the superhero, you find that as an issue and you go and deal with it with management is crap, frankly. That's got nothing to do with a social integration, nothing to do with building real self-confidence. It's always got to be about, can you get other people to do something? So if there's a problem, don't say, I'll sort it out. What can we do? What can we do in this section? And that applies at every level. So if you're going around with a leaflet or a petition, always think, is there somebody else you could get to do even the smallest thing? And don't forget how important small things, for somebody who's not being active, little things, like I'll give an example from my work. It's not because it's fantastic, but I can talk about that with some level of detail. There's a newspaper we produce inside the NUT called Campaign Teachers. We sort of left this newspaper, you know. I was busy the other week, and I wanted to get that into everybody's pigeonhole in the staff room. So a little thing, go to somebody and say, look, I'm really busy, could you go and put them in everybody's pigeonhole? Now, at one level, there's nothing radical about that. Somebody stood there with a pile of newspapers and put them in some boxes. What's important is not what was done, the fact that somebody else did something which contributed to that sense of collective organisation in the workplace. And always, as you go around talking to people, ask that question, is there even the tiniest thing? So you want to have a conversation with somebody, how about suggesting, look, I've got 10 people to talk to, could you go and talk to that person because I've heard there's an issue over there, find out what's going on in that section. For somebody to do that act of taking the responsibility to do something as well as you, to do something even as simple as going to ask them to have a conversation with somebody else about something connected with the organisation, those little microscopic molecular details about increasing the level of self-activity, it's out of that that you begin to bind together that sense it's a collective organisation. Of course, it can be bigger things than that when you go on strike and so on, but on a daily basis, there are always opportunities to get somebody else to do even the smallest thing. I think that's another important principle. Third point I want to raise is, to be a good activist, you have to have a very good grasp of English grammar. Now, I haven't turned into Michael Gove, and one earlier, let's have teach kids about grammar and punctuation, but you have to know there's a fundamental difference between the singular and the plural in English grammar, and the words I and we should never cross your lips if at all possible, and the word should always be we and us. And I think that's, again, that might sound a bit sort of flippant, but it's extremely important. It is not about what individuals or you as an activist or a rep do, it should always be about what we can do, what we as a union group to do, what we as a collective do. So when you go to speak, for example, to management of some kinds, if ever you're a union activist or a rep, and you find yourself using language like I think, or you know, this is what I want, this is what I need to be done, alarm bells should ring. That's not the right approach. Always it should be about, can we have a little meeting? It might be a formal meeting, it might be an informal discussion, but when you go, best still if you can take somebody else to go with you, because that increases their level of activity, underlines that it's about a collective organisation. The language should always be, we think this, we want this, and we're always about collective and plural, not singular. A couple of other points. Fourth point I think is extremely important, is don't give management excuses. Never ever give management excuses to have a go at you for anything other than your union activity. And again, that sounds trivial, but unfortunately, if you're going to be active at work and be somebody who's just fighting and a rebel and trying to take on management, not surprisingly, the management aren't especially going to like that fact. And if they could find easy ways to get rid of you and discipline you and get you out of the workplace, of course they're going to do that. That's common sense. So don't give them excuses. If they're going to go for you, it needs to be something that your workplace think they just have to go at you because you're in the union, because you're a rep or something like that, or an activist. So it does mean simple things. Your work record, unfortunately, if you're a union activist, needs to be exemplary. So you don't throw silly signals, don't turn up late, don't do things at work that you know are going to get you into disciplinary charges. So there's little things, like if you're not supposed to use the works photocopy if you're in that kind of workplace to do union stuff. Some places have agreements to do that, but if you don't do it. Because if you get caught doing that, you're going to be in trouble. The same thing applies. Of course, modern technology is a marvellous thing. Emails, Facebook, all those kind of things. Don't assume at some stage, if management want, they can find out. When you send an email, I'll give an example in schools, if you're supposed to be teaching year sevens between 11 o'clock and 12 o'clock, it's not a good idea at 11:15 to send an email to somebody about union matters, because it's logged on the system and they can check that if they want, and then they say, you were supposed to be doing your job, you weren't doing it. So be careful about things like that. Just take some degree of care. Don't put things on Facebook that you wouldn't be happy about your boss reading, because it's not secure. So don't say, again, I'll use the example of a school, the head's an effing wanker. That's not a clever thing to put on, because suppose the head gets to read that, you've got a problem. And so a degree of caution. I don't mean being cautious in terms of what you fight for at work, but always thinking, I don't want to be attacked by management for anything other than the fact that I'm challenging them as a union rep and changing conditions. Don't give silly excuses away.
Fifth point.
Which is that if you're an activist, you want to seem to be, the name varies in different industries, in different words, but a rep, a shop steward, someone to embody that level of collective organisation. Where possible, if there's a procedure for that, you've got union recognition, stand for rep, become a shop steward. Best still, though, don't do it as an individual. I think it's very good practice if you want to try and get some level of organisation in the workplace. Why not have joint reps? In most schools in the area where our tower hamlets now, we have a rule that we want two NUT reps, because it's better having two people doing it than one person. It's a small step in the direction of collectivising things, which people should fight to do that, and to get a reputation in the workplace as the person who is up for a fight, who's up to challenge things, who's up to, you know, having a bit of a pop at management and so on. You want that reputation as the person who's the fight, or the group of people who are the fighters, the rebels, because that gives a sense of what we're trying to achieve in the workplace. But one thing's very important, never ever forget that even if you become a shop steward, a rep or anything like that, you are accountable. You are the representative, whatever the formal name is, you are representing the collective. So it's not you as a rep deciding things. So very always, if you are a rep or an activist, whatever you do, it's always good practice. Start by, let's have some kind of meeting. Now how you do that will vary enormously. In my workplace, we've got the right to have union meetings on the premises at lunch times, and we can announce them over the school tannoy system, no problem at all. So we regularly will have a meeting. Other places, you'll have to use other methods. You might have to meet in a cafe around lunchtime, or after work, you might have to go to a pub or somewhere like that and get people together. But before you do anything at work, it's always a good idea, in some form or another, get some people together, discuss it, and agree. If you can have a vote, that's always good, to give people ownership of what this is, what we are going to do. You might be the rep who then has to go and do something about it, go and speak to management or take up some issue, but the ownership of that decision is not yours. You're accountable to your workmates, and you want as far as possible for the people you work with in one way or another to feel some responsibility and ownership for that activity. So you're accountable, and the same applies afterwards. Whatever's happened in a workplace, always get in the habit of reporting back. Again, it might be to a formal meeting, it might be informally, but if you've had to go and see management, make sure you go back and say, this is what they say, this is what we just, and now what are we going to do about about it. And if, again, if you want to go on any union causes, any time off work, it's not your decision as a rep. As a rep, you as an individual don't have the right to say, I'm off to some union course for a week. You're representing your workmates, so go to your workmates and explain to them there's an opportunity to go on this or that event or course. You know, I think it would be useful, what do you think, blah, blah, blah. Agree it collectively as far as possible. Always that sense you're accountable as a rep, you're representing the collective, it's not about you as an individual. Sixth point I want to make is, applies not to every workplace, but in some workplaces there is the possibility where you've got some degree of union organisation and recognition, or having what broadly is called facilities time of different kinds, where you get some paid time off work to do union activities. Now that's a very good thing, and we want to defend that absolutely. It's a gain of the organised working class movement that you have the right to certain, you know, time and facilities at work to do that. So we defend that absolutely against management. And if you can get a lot of schools, you can get an hour a week off the timetable to be, if you're a union rep, that's a fantastic thing. And in some cases, you can get more facilities time. Now, that's a good thing, and where possible, sometimes people have to do that, but I think there are great dangers in that when people see that the key level of organisation in the union are people who are not doing the job day in, day out, but are sitting in a union office, are sitting in meetings with management, or who are slightly removed. Of course, we want to defend that against management, but the slide where you see that the key layer of organisation in the union is the branch secretary, is the people person who's got 3, 4, even 5 days out of the workplace, those people are servants of the rank and file workers, accountable to the rank and file workers, and they are not the key layer in the union. You do not have to have facilities time to be a good union activist or a union rep. And in fact, as far as possible, we want the ownership, the dynamic, the drive in union activity to come from below. Ordinary people doing the job, that you're doing the same job alongside them, the rank and file, in other words, that's got to be the key area of our of activity and the key area of our operation. And even if you get a position where you do have some facilities time, it's all too easy to see that. I know I've told a lot of people in our union where they think the key thing in the union is the branch secretary and the branch officer, and what they talk about is, oh, I was in this meeting, I was talking to management about that, I was doing this in the union office, I phoned this, all of which is very useful and important, but that becomes what the union is about. It's not what the union is about. If you're in an office or a factory or a workplace, it's the people you're working alongside and what you do day in, day out while you're doing the job to try and improve your conditions. It's got to always focus down below, not on the people with facilities time. Now, there are lots of discussions and arguments to that. My personal view is that it's a very bad idea, if you're a socialist, to be on 100% facility time if you can avoid it. If you're 5 days a week out of the office, out of the school, out of the hospital, out of the factory, whatever it is, sitting in a union office and so on, sometimes it may be unavoidable because of the structure of different unions to take such positions, but as far as possible, that's a bad idea and we should do what we can not to be in that position. So I know we've had a long discussion in the teachers' organisation, the SWP for instance, where now we're saying that if a position like that becomes available and politically it's agreed that would be a good idea for the socialists to stand for that, then what you should do is say, well, I'm not taking 5 days facility time. I'll take 2 or 3 days maximum, and the other days that are available, we'll find some other people to share it out, so it becomes a more collective thing, and still, 2 or 3 days a week, you're going back into the workplace, doing the same job alongside your workmates, suffering the same conditions as them, and be in touch in that way. You don't want to remove yourself. The biggest disaster, I think, in a workplace is if your workmates think you're the person who's always seeking to be out of the workplace, away from the pressures of the daily job. And again, I'll use the example of a school. If you are not in front of a class teaching kids, dealing with all of those issues and the crap that management ask you, all the rubbish paperwork and accountability, if you're not doing that for at least some of the week, I think that's a problem, really. You're beginning to remove yourself a little bit, and that's a big discussion that we need to have. Seventh point I want to raise is, and this comes back to a discussion that some people were in a meeting last night on organising in the trade unions, and the two connected points here, we're against all forms of sectionalism. Let me explain what I mean by that. Of course you want to start from what can you get in your workplace? Can you get increase the level of collective organisation in your section, your office, or your part of the workplace? That's extremely important. It's the fundamental basis on which all workers can begin to get some degree of collective organisation and strength. But it's not enough on its own. And as a socialist, we're always trying to look beyond that in two different but connected ways. The first thing as a socialist, we always start not from the fact that we're divided up in different workplaces and unions. You're not a health worker, a teacher, a miner, a factory worker, whatever it is. We're members of the working class. And that means always and at every opportunity, you're seeking to bring that idea into your workplace. So that means a number of things. So, for example, whatever you're doing, if there's a strike on, or a dispute, or a local campaign of some kind, how can you bring that into your workplace? So if you're, for example, a hospital worker, and you hear that there is a factory down the road on strike, it's extremely important in terms of bringing that idea of collective organisation of the working class, that you as a union activist think, I'm going to be the person, and if possible get somebody else to help you with it, who's going to take the petition, the collection, the solidarity, the message of support, and go around to all my workmates and say, will you sign this petition? Will you sign this message of support? Will you give to this collection? And best of all, if you can, will one or two of you come with me when I go down to that picket line and give it over to those workers? It might be a global campaign against cuts. It might be students protesting against fees. Can you go around, for example, with a petition saying we support the students who are demonstrating against fees and get that inserted, and why don't a few of us then try and go down to the local university or a local campaign meeting and give that over? It's important because it increases the level of activity in the workplace. It's also important because it begins to challenge that idea of sectional division, that we might be organising in the workplace, but our interest are looking at the wider working class, and every fight is our fight, and all members of the working class are our brothers and sisters. And in small ways, that's bringing that into the workplace. It doesn't have to be just solidarity as well. The question of bringing in wider issues. People aren't just concerned about pay, conditions, all of those things, important as they are. Nobody just thinks like that. Questions of racism, questions of war, political, big political questions, the things that the ruling class use to divide workers. We're divided up by section, but they try and use racism to divide workers. They try and use questions of nationalism and jingoism and so on to divide workers. So in small ways, can you begin to challenge that as an activist? That can be simple things. The EDL are coming to try and march in your town. Are you the person at work who thinks, I'm going to go around my workplace and raise that with people? It might be a petition, it might be conversations. But saying, actually, I don't think the EDL should come here, and I think I want to challenge that idea, and I want to try and go to that protest. Will some of you either sign a petition or come with me to that meeting? You won't always succeed. You might have to go back to that. This time they might not agree with you. There's nothing wrong with raising an argument with people and losing it. You might have an argument about the war in Afghanistan. Will you sign something against that? Because I'm going to an anti-war protest this evening. You might lose the argument. People might say no. Fine, have the argument again. Never write people off, though. Don't assume because somebody didn't agree with you this time that in a month's time, 2 months' time, 3 months' time, they're not open to persuasion again. And there's always a danger in a workplace. I think that you reduce yourself down to the people who agree with you. There'll be people who disagree with you fundamentally on all sorts of things. Get in the habit of very nicely, very politely, as a union activist, going back to them. I know you didn't sign this last time, but I want to have another conversation with you. And you have to be very patient, but over time, if you get in that habit, the experience and most experienced workplace activist, it does begin to change people. You know, one of our fundamental beliefs is that workers do change. The experience of work, the experience of discussion, the experience of beginning to be part of collective organisation opens people up and it changes people's minds. It's often a slow and contradictory process, but always think everybody in this workplace, however far and removed they seem from you at the moment, if you bind them into levels of collective organising, increase their level of self-activity and continue that level of discussion where you're challenging ideas, over time that does actually make a difference. It doesn't always seem like it when you're getting battered back by people, but actually over time it really does make a difference. So challenging sectionalism in that way. And a third way we need to challenge sectionalism, I think, is a simple thing. I think it's a good idea for every activist in a workplace, after work, lunchtime, to go for a walk for 10 minutes around where you work. And just make a note of all the workplaces. You'd be surprised what you discover. And obviously, if you're miles out in the countryside and isolated plant, that's a bit more difficult. But often, people do have that possibility. And just look, oh, there's a fire station. Oh, there's a civil service office. There's a little hospital. There's a little factory and so on. I wonder who the union reps in there, who the union activists in there. You're not just thinking about your section. Are the connections I can make? You might start from workplaces that are the same as yours. Again, if you're in a school, usually there are other schools within walking distance. Well, go and ask them. Get your local union branch and ask them, have you got information about that? Phone them up, send them an email. But the old-fashioned method, there's no law in this country that says you can't walk into a local workplace. Have a bit of front. You know, walk up to a workplace, excuse me, I've come on union business to whoever's the security is that you are. Can I speak to the union rep in here if there is one? It might not be a one, you might get knocked back, but actually you'll be surprised how often with a little bit of brass, they'll say, oh, I'll just get them for you. And then you might not have a long conversation for them, but you can swap phone numbers and things like that and arrange to have a chat later on. It won't always work, but it's surprising how easy that can be if you make a point of doing it. And that really helps, because if you come to the point where you're taking some level of action or you're doing something, whatever it is, you then begin to get a network in a local area. So if you go on strike, for instance, you phone them and say, will you come to our picket line or whatever? Or there might be a campaign you're taking up, a petition of solidarity with another group of workers you're taking up. Well, phone up those people you've met in the nearby workplace and say, oh, by the way, I'm going around my workplace with a petition in support of the bus workers who are out on strike this week. Would you like me to pop one round? Maybe you want to do it in your workplace as well. You begin to increase that sense of class organisation in the local area. It's slow and uneven and lots of patient work, lots more shoe leather needs to be worn out, but it's extremely important to at least make the attempt to do that. Ninth point, second off last point, is what I'd say about not just focusing on your section. There's another way it's important, is that it's not just about going beyond your section, you also have to think about your union organisation, if you've got one. Now, obviously this applies mainly to places where people have organised unions, but you have to take some responsibility for going beyond your workplace to the wider organisation of your union. There's probably a local union branch which represents people in a number of workplaces. You can't not go to that. If you don't go and try and shape the union organisation, other people will. And most people will not agree with what you want to do. There'll be other forces in the unions who will try and shape them, as anybody who's been active in the union knows. You have a responsibility, not just to build in your workplace, whatever it might be, but to say, what can I then do to begin to shape the wider trade union that I'm active? So it does mean, however boring it can be sometimes, you have to go to your local union branch and play an active part. If it's a bit dead and boring one, well, there are no shortcuts. What can I do about that? Is there one or two other people who agree with me? Can we find a way to raise something, make it more interesting? Can we bring some fresh people to the union branch? Begin at least the project of trying to change it, and again, patience is necessary. And that applies at every level at the union. There'll be different conferences. Lots of unions might have things for young members, for black members, for lesbian and gay members. We'll find out about them. You might be able to go to some of them, and they'll find other activists. If you don't do that, other people are going to do it. The same when it comes to national conferences and things like that. Most unions will have conferences. If people who are active at a rank and file level and are socialist politics aren't beginning to find out how to do something about that, to get elected, to go there, to meet with like-minded people, possibly in some kind of left organisation within the union, and try and shape the union, other people will shape it in a different way. There's not an option here to abstain from that. In different ways, you have to engage with that process. Last point, all of that's about activity and what to do, but that also needs to be informed by a level of political understanding. You have to bring politics in two different ways, just to sum up. I think it's extremely important that if you're active in a workplace, you at least find out about and learn and understand some of the things that we are sort of arguing about the nature of the trade unions. It increases your effectiveness as an activist. So you need to understand that fundamental division in the trade unions between the bureaucracy and the rank and file. The role of the full-time trade union bureaucracy, because of the contradictory nature of unions, that they're seeking to make compromises, improve things within the system, not overthrow the system. I haven't got time to win all of the argument here. There are other meetings at Marxism which will discuss this in more depth. But there is a fundamental difference between the bureaucracy who are always seeking to make agreements, compromises and so on to remove from the day-to-day experience of work, and rank and file workers. And that's the fundamental difference. And the more you understand about the history, the traditions of that, the more effective you're going to be in getting things right in terms of your activity as a workplace. So if people aren't familiar with that, they need to read about that, familiarise themselves, talk to people about water meetings and Marxism, and understand that it informs how you operate. Anybody who's been through in the public sector, the dispute over pensions the last year, if you didn't have some grasp on that relationship between the bureaucracy and the rank and file, you would have found yourself all at sea in the way things have chopped and changed and great high points and struggles to suddenly things going down and so on. Having a set of ideas which make sense of that, a compass if you like to guide you through those stormy waters, is essential equipment to begin to develop. That doesn't mean we're indifferent to the question of left and right union leaders. It's absolutely true. There is a big difference between having a left union controlled union and a right union. You need to understand that and work for that, but also understanding that's subordinate to the more fundamental distinction between the bureaucracy and the rank and file. And the last, very last point is be political and be patient. In a workplace, you want every worker in the union, one exception I would say is the very rare exception if you've got an organised Nazi in the workplace, you need to find out who out and dealt with. But even Tories, you want Tories in the union. It's about collective organisation. Every worker is in the union and you have to relate to them and talk to them. You might disagree with everything they say, but you still have to talk to them about what you can do to improve pay and conditions. Still ask them if they'll sign the collection. You have to do that. It's about everybody being involved. But that just because you have to talk and relate and discuss with them doesn't mean you don't argue with people at work. You have to bring those arguments. If you think it's wrong, for instance, that Britain's got troops in Afghanistan, well, you won't argue that in your workplace. If you don't raise your politics, what will happen sooner or later, if you're quiet about it, somebody will find out. They'll see you selling socialist work, probably, and you will lose respect because you haven't been open and honest with people. It's always important. If you are political, talk to people about it. You'll win, even if people don't agree with you, you'll win respect for that. It's doing to bring politics into the workplace. And the final point, be patient. You can't change a workplace. It's very rare, there might be an explosion of struggle, but in most circumstances, you're not going to change an unorganised, a weakly organised workplace into a very well organised workplace in 3 weeks flat. It requires patience, time, lots more shoe leather, lots more conversations. So be impatient in terms of what you're trying to do, but also have patience that it does take time. Over time, if you work in the right way, it does actually change things. If you talk to experienced trade union activists, well, you think, oh, they've got really good union organisation in their workplace. Ask any one of them if it was like that 3 years, 4 years, 5 years ago. And most of the time, it wasn't. It's a process that you go through. Where you've got good union organisation, it's not because somebody's that fantastic, it's because they've had a set of politics and approach looking to collective organisation, rank and file ethos in terms of how they approach things, and over time that approach has actually made a difference and it's politicised the workplace, made for a more effective organisation. Now obviously the details of how you apply all of that vary enormously. It's, you know, there is no recipe for it, and maybe that's some of the discussion we can have now about how we translate some of this into effective practice. And what I would do is, obviously, if people have good stories, we're going to do a new edition of the pamphlet in the autumn, with people talking about what they've done. So it's not me writing in the pamphlet, but it's people's voices from how they've organised that work, because that's better than anything I can say. So thank you.
Paul talked about how, as well as shoe leather, to organise, you need ears. One of the things that you certainly need to challenge, particularly in places that have little to no organisation, is or certainly kind of shut your ears to and persevere, is the idea you can't organise it in. That's what I kind of came up with against a few years ago. Was involved in an organising campaign in a call centre. And these were not just the words of kind of people that you work with, but very kind of unconfident and so on. Those are the words of the local branch officials to the full-time organiser that was starting to help me. He said, they've got no chance of organising in that call centre. The turnover's too high. All sorts of reasons and so on. Now, I'm glad to say that we kind of... made him eat his words when we managed to get 120 people in the union in that call centre, won the first pay increases in that workplace, and got loads of people involved in that union. There were a number of kind of victimisation campaigns by managing these people that we successfully won, including my own, where I was sacked for kind of writing an article in Socialist Worker, and we managed to kind of win that. And I think we need to kind of close our ears to that. I think I was at the meeting yesterday on the 1972, the year that the workers brought down a Tory government. Well, the best question at that meeting came from a young worker who's just started out in the workplace. He said, I talk to people about all these things. I talk to people about the kind of the high points of class struggle and what's possible and the rest of it. And I talk to people, and it just seems that people aren't interested. And there's a level of perseverance, and it, again, it comes back to the listening. It's about finding the issues. There'll be one issue, and you'll never know what it is, that will come up that will annoy the bejesus out of everybody, and one that you can actually start to organise around. And actually, it's at that time that you'll be able to, that people then see the sense when you start organising, start winning things, You see the sense then, people see the sense in terms of solidarity, the working class, and all the rest of it. One final thing, I think, I'm not sure if Paul mentioned this, I think there's two major hazards. Of course, yes, they'll try and sack you. Paul's absolutely right. People need to make sure that they avoid being disciplined. The other one is, they'll try, if you're any bloody good, they'll try and promote you. They'll try and incorporate you. That, they'll tell you what, that happens time and time again. And we need to have a hard argument about that.
Yeah, I think it's fantastically important that Paul's produced that that pamphlet, because I just think it's amazing in the whole movement, there was no pamphlet about how to organise at work. You know, none of the unions had one, the TUC didn't have one. And I think it's really a reflection of just how neglected this area of work's been, and we've got to win more socialists and more activists to actually engaging at work. But as Paul said, I think, you know, it's quite hard to summarise what to do in, you know, a 25-minute talk or whatever. And I think that's the importance of having that kind of network of activists that people can, you know, when they bump up against some problem at work, you know, what am I going to do about this or whatever. And I think, you know, the party organisation is really important for that, so people can discuss through how to overcome those different barriers that people come up against. I wanted to say a couple of things about the practicalities. I mean, I think the first thing is, if you're starting off in a workplace where there's no organisation at all, if you start agitating around some workplace issue, the employer is likely to react in quite a robust way. And I know it seems harder to start with something political, because that's like a harder thing to win other people to, but it can often actually be safer. You know, an employer is less likely to see it as a direct threat if you're moaning on about what the government's doing or whatever, than if you're moaning on about what they're doing. So even though it might be harder to win over workmates, if you can find a few allies within your workplace by taking up a political issue, you've kind of got a side to then start taking up some of the more nitty-gritty issues. And the last thing really was about issues, because I think if you go to any of the unions, and it'll depend who you talk to and which union you're in, and you talk about, all right, I want to build a union in my workplace, quite often you'll get told, you know, here's 10 reasons to join the union, and it's all about, you know, getting a free will, or, you know, what the union can do for you, or the legal services, whatever. And that is not why people join unions. It's about the collective organisation Paul's talking about, and that's about issues, right? People join a union because they're annoyed about something. I think a key thing is to grasp, you know, if you're starting off, how do you pick an issue to organise around? You know, it's probably not, I mean, I work for a big multinational in a largely ununionised industry, right? If you picked, you know, we want to stop them offshoring work to India, that's probably not the first issue I'm going to win on, right? You know, you need to start with something you know that people care about deeply, that lots of people care about, and that you potentially can win on and raise people's confidence that they can then move on to some of the other issues as well. And in communicating with people, I think, you know, we do like newsletters. We often neglect, I think, some of the basic things about communication. Loads of people don't even really know what a union is if they start in an unorganised industry. You know, you have to kind of go through some of the basic explanation about trade unionism. You have to talk about your successes. I think generally we're really bad at telling people what we've won, and that always raises people's confidence. I think talking about the current issues and what people can do about them. And finally, I think inoculation is a word we should use a bit more, which is about warning people what the employer is likely to do or likely to say, so we're getting our retaliation in first, and avoiding people being freaked out when they do something bad.
Increasingly, one of the problems is that the way employment is changing, you're getting, you may well find that the people in your sort of work area don't all work in the same place as you. They're scattered geographically, often, you know, over 20, 30, 40 miles or even the other end of the country, which makes organising much more difficult. And I think it I think the thing about newsletters is important. I think one of the other things is using email groups, because that means not only that you can talk to the members or send stuff out to members, but they can also reply to you. And it's also more secure, so people are more confident about doing that. I mean, I think it's lovely when your employer says you can use our email system, but it's dangerous, because if you rely on that, come a dispute, they are likely to stop you using it. And if you haven't actually got an alternative communication system, you can be in quite serious trouble, because you need So I think it's better in any case, regardless of what they say, you can have to have your own separate thing. I think one of the other things is there is always something you can do about an issue. Even if you can't get a strike, maybe you can get a protest. If you can't get a protest, maybe you can get everyone to sign an open letter of complaint. And in the final solution, I've found that even just articulating people's concerns is actually makes people feel better, makes the union seem like it's doing something. If all you've done is you have to write from the newsletter why management are crap, why what they're saying is a load of bollocks, and what other people have done about it. You know, those sorts of things can enormously help. I think one of the other things to say is that you will find amongst many other socialists, not in our organisation, other organisations, the temptation to do manoeuvres. The idea that there is a motion that you desperately want to put forward to the branch to go forward to conference, and you know that your members are not going to support it. And so the temptation to just put it forward and not, in fact, an awful lot of people never bother with things like mandating. But if you do that, I mean, the simple question is, if you pass that motion, what the hell does it mean? Because if you haven't got support, ask yourself, could you win if there was a strike over that motion, when you couldn't get your members out, what the hell is the point of that? And the thing is you do lose respect by doing stupid things like that. You know, it's much better to have the argument and lose it than not to have the argument in the first place and win something which doesn't mean anything.
The first thing is reps being elected as steward rep. Yeah, it's true, we do need to be elected as steward rep. One of the things you might find is people will say, oh yeah, you be the rep. You know, I don't want to do it, you be it. And you've got to avoid that. And even if you're unopposed, still have a meeting, still be elected. Because then you've got a mandate to do the things you want to do and hold that regularly every 6 months, every year. Constant voting of positions. And just the email thing, I think people just don't respond to emails, I've found. Emails can be useful when we talk, the left-wing people in an area communicate through email because you can have a discussion about something quite easily. But actually, if you're talking about the workplace, for me, it's what you were saying about face-to-face and going around talking to people. That's what people respond to. So I would sort of like be, I think there's a discussion to be had about it, but I would always be careful when we come to electronic communication and in terms of, does that actually connect to people? I think there's a discussion to be had about that. I would argue for committees in every workplace, not like a rank and file committee, anything scary like that. A committee in the sense of like, in our place, we have like a publicity secretary, and all he does is put the posters up on the union notice board, and that's his job. Now, you know, it sounds very formal, but that's what you need. It needs to look organised, it needs to have the feel of organisation. And every time he puts a poster up each week, he's being part of the union, and he's doing something for the union. And we have a membership secretary, all she does is she has the joining forms, and if you talk to someone about joining, go and get a form off her, rather than me just pulling the form out to go to somebody else. So there's two people. We have a chair for meetings as well. And all she has to do is chair the meetings. So there's three people on your committee. We've got two reps. Well, there's a committee of five people out of a membership of 30 people. Well, you can see how this thing about cogs and all this business, you know, that's how it works. You've got a minority of people who you're talking to, and they can go and relate to others as well. I'll just cut short. I just want to say something about union branches as well. We need networks of people who can actually revitalise union branches. You know, ask yourself, your union branch, how old are the people there? How many turn up to regular meetings? You know, are they actually connected to workplaces? I've found union branches, you might get a regular five or six people. Half of those are retired members. I'll just sum up now. Half of those retired members, they've got to be revitalised with young people, with new reps, new activists. But it's about finding out who those people are, even in your own workplace. And even if it's just one person you can take to a union branch who's an active rep, well, that's going to revitalise, hopefully, and start to shift some of this bureaucratic right-wing stuff that's going on. And not just the right as well, but the left-wing people in the union branches need to be removed as well, frankly. And we've got to revitalise it. It's got to be focused on the workplace. Somebody said yesterday, even Martin Smith got it spot on. It's all about the workplace. It's all about where you are. It's not about left fractions, broad lefts and all this kind of stuff. It's about the people that you work with and about the organisation at the base of the union and in the workplaces. And that's where we need to be organised.
I wanted to talk about the importance of the theory and being honest with the people around us, because the theory about the trade union bureaucracy is you can read it, but it's when you live it that it really kind of makes sense. And recently, in terms of being a teacher in London, I don't want to bore everyone with it, I'm sure some of you have followed it, but we went from the 2.5 million in November to a call out of just London teachers in the UCU and NUT. And if we'd gone into our union meetings going onwards and upwards, we can keep the fight going, it's where we were, which some people were tempted to do, everyone had looked at us like we were nuts, because that's not where we were. We had to say, this is not where we want to be. This is a disaster for us. But if we don't fight, it's over. And nothing has changed, even if our union leaders have sold us out. And we used the word condemn, not regret what they did. It was really an important argument about how the rank and file is vital, but we can't do it without the bureaucrats at the moment. We're not strong enough. And I'm just saying that, you know, you have to be honest, because it's not our clever little secret theory that we keep to ourselves because we're so clever. We actually want to win people, therefore we talk honestly with everyone around us. We want them to be arguing what we're arguing. We don't want to argue it on our own. And without being honest, you can't do that. And the second thing I wanted to say is the most concrete and often the most scary way of having a political relationship with the people you work with, if you get out a revolutionary paper and you walk around and try and sell it. That way, you instantly, obviously this is, if you can, you don't, you know, what, depending on the workplace you're in, but if you're a trade unionist in a school or public sector workplace, you're not going to be sacked at the moment for selling socialist worker. And if you want to have a link with people and find out where their politics are, that is the most concrete way to do it. And there's another concrete thing about it, is how many did you sell? I know that there are factions, a Haringey caucus, I know, talk about the general politics and then finish off with how many papers did you sell in your school this week? And I think we should be very proud of that, make sure that we try and do it. And every new member, we try and encourage to do it. I don't do it every week. I don't do it particularly well. Sometimes I'm lazy and I just go with the people I normally sell to. But actually, yeah, just to say, if you have people you normally sell to, they are your instant place to go when things kick off.
Yeah, just a few points. Two in particular, actually, we've only got a bit of time. Email groups, my experience of email groups is lends me to think that maybe you shouldn't do it, really. Because we set up a subgroup, I work for the on the railway, I'm in the RMT, and the people who work on the trains don't tend to come to branch meetings. So they set up this email group. But I think our experience is it's not encouraged activity, it's encouraged passivity. It's encouraged, you know, the situation where the, you know, the more right-wing elements who are the most vocal on the email groups and all this tend to sway things. You know, it's create a situation where the right leads the left. It's also some of that down to the calibre of the reps and in that section as well. But you know, and people get really sloppy with it. So they, you know, this email thing goes through the company server and they say all kind of things on it. And you think, what are you doing? Are you asking to be sacked? Do you want to give the game away? And you know, no wonder the management one step ahead of you. But the other thing I want to talk about was the last thing Paul mentioned was the politics, and he says, you know, except when you got you want everyone to be in the union, except when they're an organised Nazi. And I think, well, actually, that's not true either. It's you may have been a workplace where there's an organised Nazi, and you may not be able to get rid of them. You may have to deal with it, you know, confront it politically. You know, it's really nice when you are in a workplace and you've got a strength of organisation and people around you that you can turn around, right, we're going to have a strike about this person and get them out. But what about when you're not? What about, like, my place, in the other shift, there's, like, come the GLA election, there's about seven of them were going around openly saying they're going to vote for the BNP. You know, there wasn't a lot of point of drawing a line in the sand that the next day you're going to have to cross over because you're going to have to work with these people and you're not going to be able to get it. Tackle. The way it was dealt with, we dealt with it, and because it was me, I went, all right, just very briefly, we were very forthright about our attitude towards Nazis. We went around publicising the EDL demonstrations, we're getting delegations onto it. We had one guy, actually one of the people who said he was a Nazi, he actually came out onto that demonstration. But whenever anyone said that, well, we'll be on the other side, we were quite clear about, well, what's going to happen if we meet you. We're not going to be friends about this. You know, but so we didn't sort of, you know, back down or be quiet about it. But we weren't going to be able to get rid of these people. But we had to, that's how we challenged the politics.
I was a representative for many years, and I finished as a senior rep in my workplace last year. And there's lots of things I'd like to say. I think your meeting's absolutely excellent. You said all all the right things about organising, and I've got a lot of experience of both doing it wrong and doing it right, you know. I know in my last workplace, which was Marconi and Kay Merrickson, you might have heard of, we have many, many years of drip of people leaving and redundancies and what have you. And we started off fighting them with some strike action, limited strike action, but in the end, under those years, we were losing a lot of the time. And we constantly talked to our members and produced bulletins and everything, and we had a senior rep who was something of a hero, you know, he was a Chilean refugee who withstood torture under the Pinochet regime. But and he was excellent, and he still is an excellent guy, and he's still active today, although he's on one of our national committees in our union, because of having got there from his workplace when he no longer represents it, which I think doesn't really mean anything. You know, I wouldn't carry on doing that. But I think what's important is that despite all the work that he did, you know, we never actually built a reps organisation for years. The reps organisation went down so that when he left, he actually got victimised in the end. There was only two representatives there. I was one of them, and I tried to argue we should have joint representatives at that point, you know. And we did it for a little while, and then the other guy left, and then I became the representative, you know. But I had no choice then but to follow the politics that I'd learned, you know, that I felt that we should conduct themselves. The first thing that happened when I was there was there's a group of people who weren't actually part of the organised of the union. We were down to under 25% of our workplace unionisation. And there's one area where we have hardly any members. They suddenly got told that when we moved sites, they were going to change their contract, right? And actually, legalistically, it didn't really mean very much. But potentially, it meant that they could have to work longer hours and work in different workplaces around the country. And they were up in arms about it, right? Now, previous reps may well have argued with them that this doesn't really mean very much. But I could see that they were really concerned about it, and they wanted to make a stand now. So we organised with those people. And the company said, well, if they don't sign this new contract, they will not be allowed to move to the new site. So I told these people, well, don't sign the new contract, you know. Nobody signed. The company said, there's no way we can change this. It was set up in Sweden, who were the new bosses, you know. It applies to all of Ericsson nationally. There's no way we can change this contract now. And we said, well, we're not going to sign it, you know. In the end, we got that signed. And that section became fully unionised. Later on, we faced other threats. But from that section, we built out. And we got the union to where we had over 50% membership by the time I left. And I think it was based on the biggest thing that I think what Paul McGarr said, all right, I'll have to wind up. But the biggest thing is that when members are concerned about something, when a small group of members are concerned and they want to take a stand against something, that is absolute gold. That's what matters most, that we get in there and we use that to build the union, not that we, you know, we're just trying to pursue what we think is important. And that's, I think, one of the most important things you said.
Right, actually, looking at me, I've been around a bit, but I think there's a fantastic amount to learn from this pamphlet. I thought it was absolutely excellent, and one of the first things I did was actually give it to a new activist who only just got involved in the union. You wouldn't normally think, well, the first thing I give them is something from Socialist Worker, give them the union official thing, but it's just in such simple terms. Anyone who's not got it, I'd recommend it, and you can use it, you know, people that are really new to the union. And I think people have already mentioned it. I think the importance of involving as many people in the activities of the union, getting to them to do some little bit. You know, I think Paul's idea of having two people do the job, or most unions now you have job shares and all that. You know, find a role for absolutely everyone, because there's always something they can do. You know, you always find one there. And I think the other thing with meetings, you know, we have small executive meetings. I think they should always be open to all union members. They should always be at the time when any union member can get. They can come along and bring up anything they like. Something we've just recently learned, working in the government office, we have a council chamber. That's where we normally had our meetings, or one of their meeting rooms. So it's a bit hit and miss who gets along. And obviously the people who have to work for the lunch hours, you know, the benefit staff and so on, it's really difficult for them to all get along. Well, this time along, something management wanted about single status agreement. So we asked for time off. We had the meetings in all the offices. Not done that for years. It's been really good turnout. You know, 50% of members attending union meetings throughout the branch, which is, you know, pretty good turnout. And having done that, we now got the issue of pensions. We've gone back to management again to ask for time off. So yeah, they've had to give it again, this time again back in the workplaces, and it kind of reinvigorates yourself. So, you know, there are always things you can learn. Just finally, something I want to say, which hasn't been mentioned, it's on the issue of casework, because some union activists get bogged down in this. And my answer to this, yeah, you've got to do it well, but see how you can always generalise it, involves the rest in the section on it. I think it's quite an important issue, because too often I hear, you know, activists start talking about casework. It bores me no end. It is important you win it, but I think you've always got to look, how can you generalise it, make it more than just an individual's case.
Anecdote about the I and we aspect that you were talking about, Paul. I work for a professional association. They're quite well established. We had our first strike in 180 years, well, the first ever strike in this organisation just a couple of weeks ago. And the I and the we thing was, we asked, there's national offices around the country, and there's one in particular in Belfast, and we asked people to organise a picket line there. And we asked an individual to sort of see if they could sort it out and have a discussion with their office. And what happened was they had the discussion in the workplace, and it was like, well, we're going to organise this picket line. It wouldn't be fair for this individual to do it on their own or just with two of them. So the whole office went out and shut down the office. And it happens in Scotland and other offices around the country as well. Just a quick question then. It was about what happens when someone who you're not sure about wants to be a rep. What do you do in that situation when, you know, you might get this candidate coming forward because we're looking for more people all the time to get involved in our activity. What do you do when you get people who you're not sure about coming forward?
Yeah, just three really quick things. The first thing is about politics, because actually we've got to think about, particularly if you think about industries, you know, think about education, for example, which is now the second highest level of people doing casual work and the rest of it, other than the food industry and stuff about it. Lots of people won't come directly to the union immediately, but will have been political, have probably have been on anti-war demonstrations, anti-racist activity, all kinds of things. So therefore, if the union is political, quite often it can pull people in who wouldn't necessarily just come to the union, so we shouldn't forget about that. The second thing about it, I thought was really good what Tom was saying, stuff, is have a plan. Right, stuff inside your workplace, have a plan. It isn't just about the rep, right, and stuff. Actually, at a small scale, you can try and pull people around you if you're in a single workplace. But actually, you know, again, lots of people have got experience about being in council workplaces and the rest of it. Unless you've got a strategy as a branch for involving more people, what you end up with is the five sad, lonely individuals sitting there sweating, doing the casework, right, and stuff. But you have to have a plan to push out for your own survival and for the good of the branch. You don't need four or five heroes representing everybody in casework. What you need is a political leadership inside a branch. The last thing is about Paul's pamphlet and the argument. See, we've got, I think for a lot of people now, they now think the trade unions, right, stuff, are a way of fighting back. We necessarily, 3 or 4 years ago, wouldn't have done, right? So even 2 or 3 years ago, wouldn't have done. We've got to have a fight now amongst our own people and the people around us, right, and stuff, about our central trade union activity is. It's not this bread and butter boring clank, right, and stuff, and then we do politics to a side. We have to fuse the two things together, because actually it's the power, is in the, we use the cliche, is in the workplace. And therefore we have to inject all the energy of the movement outside into the workplace and start seeing them as a as resistance to austerity.
Yeah, just three brief points really. Yeah, just briefly on letters. I produced a 2-page A4 thing. I work in a school in East London. You know, and it just said, you know, what is a union? You know, what is Unison and what is a trade union? And I just basically explained in as briefly as I could what a trade union was, briefly where Unison came from and what the kind of job of it was. You know, representing people, you know, sort of nationally, using the example of pensions and also within the workplace. And I just found that useful, because that was the question that most people said. I said, would you like to join a union? Went, yeah, what is it? You know, so that's sort of something that can be done. Just an example from the November the 30th. I'm a teaching assistant in East London, and around me, in a sort of quarter of a mile square, is about 7 or 8 schools. So what I did is I went round. I got the list of the different stewards in some of the different schools. I went round to the different schools, and we tried to sort of form a little hub in the local area. And it means now that from that, I can kind of go into different schools and talk to different reps. And, you know, as a rep in my school, I'm also kind of always kind of looking over, making sure that the nearest school's rep make sure that they've actually got the stuff. So if over the pensions thing, I've kind of double checked, I've gone round there, I've said, oh yeah, I'll meet up with you. You know there's a meeting like next week. So that's the kind of way where Paul was saying about organising both in your workplace and outside. But I mean, there is something, you know, there isn't really enough young people in this room at the moment. And then this is a problem which we need to kind of address. And I think Michael was addressing it slightly there. And it does seem to me, certainly within, you know, the SWP and sort of layers of that, I think we need to be quite clear about making sure that student activists are encouraged. You know, we need to set up meetings in universities in the third year about what unions are and about trying to encourage people so that we can transform those student activists into, you know, constructive trade unionists in an 18-month period. They can start to become stewards and everything else in the workplace.
My name's Duncan Smith. I work for the council in Edinburgh, and I work in a massive white-collar factory. They've built a new office block right behind Waverley Station, and it holds about 2,000 white-collar workers. And it's quite interesting if you think about how you organise like that, because in my office, it's not just a small room I work in with other people at a desk and my PC and so forth. I work in a room which is 100 metres long, 50 metres wide. Every time I stand up, 20 managers can see me. So I have to be very, very careful in terms of what I do and how I speak to someone. I am open about my politics. I have the paper sitting on my desk. I have, you know, Socialist Review there as well. People talk about that. And that is the way to do it, to overcome that difficulty of actually coming out as a socialist. You have to be a bit brazen about it. But I've got a couple of questions in terms of organising my branch. We have 8,500 members in it. We also have a large number of members, home care workers, for example, who do not have a base. They work from home, they go to where they work, and they come back again. That's a very difficult group of workers to organise. Just want to have any thoughts about that. Secondly, we have a lot of agency workers coming in. Nearly all the young workers who come into my office are not employed by the council, they're employed by an agency, and they are quite difficult to organise. Again, I wonder if you have any thoughts about that. Thank you.
Yeah, Paul made a very important point, I think, about speaking for the majority in the workforce. And I think one of the important things in relation to that is not using narrow activist jargon when we're speaking for the majority, because you're just preaching to the converted. And I think one of the ways to get the same points across is to use the language of the way that management talk about we're providing a good service and so on, in the case of education or any other public sector service, and then expose what they're actually doing. And I think that breaking down divisions between the workforce, give you an example, at the university where I work, the LGBT Society did a survey that said they found out 7% of LGBT colleagues were not out to their colleagues, 15% weren't out to management. And so creating that kind of atmosphere where people feel those things can be talked about is very important, but it's also important to link. There's not a separation between bread and butter issues and wider political things. So the attempts by management to control us through performance indicators, auditing and so on, can often be linked to wider political issues about neoliberalism and the assault on public services and so on. And the aim of that is to isolate management within the workplace, that we speak for the majority, they're the minority, they're attacking our services, this is the way they're doing it, through these, you know, mechanisms of control that they're trying to use in the workplace. And through doing things like that, you can then win those wider numbers to the need for resolute action, which builds up confidence and makes people, you know, the nature of the workplace is driving people towards political solutions, and that's what we need to draw out.
I've got a lot of people made some excellent points. Just to underline some of them, I very strongly agree with the point Ian made, that if you're in a union trying to organise, you've got to get away from that idea it's about just membership and services, which is sometimes unions fall into. Like Ian said, you know, 10 reasons to join a union, you'll get a free will, you'll get this legal service, all of which is useful. That's not the key focus, nor is simply saying, you know, here's the form, join. If you want to build effective union organisation, Ian is absolutely right. What are the things in your workplace that people are annoyed about, want something done about, that you think you can get something done about? I mean, there's a slogan some unions use, is anger, hope, action. And that's not a bad way of summing up that process. What is it that people are not happy about? is there something, the possibility of doing something about, and what can we do to change it? Finding issues like that is often a good thing. I know in my own workplace, a little tiny thing, that telephone union organisation, where people have a break duty, where one supervised kids a break, and people had to cover a lesson afterwards. And people really didn't like that, because I mean, they didn't get a chance to have a cup of coffee. So we went, did something about that, got a meeting, went and managed to say, we don't like this, we want an agreement that says if you've got a break duty, you won't ask me to cover a lesson straight afterwards, so you get some free time. Tiny little thing, which means people get a chance to have a cup of coffee during the day, and that's all, the break. But we got that agreed, and that made people feel, yeah, actually, there was a point in that, the union means something. It begins to build that sense of, by coming together and doing something, we change our daily experience in small ways. Second point, the question about Nazi, I think we have to be clear that there is a difference between somebody who votes for a Nazi party and somebody who's an organised member of a Nazi party. I would not suggest at all somebody who says, I am voting for the BNP, you drive them out of the union. They're not an organised Nazi. You have to have some hard arguments with that person, and all sorts of issues come like. There is a difference between that and somebody who's an active organised member of a Nazi party. Now, most unions have policies saying they don't want those people as members. If in the unlikely, but it's very rare, so I don't want to focus too much on it, but if you have a member who's a member of a Nazi party or school, if it's possible, I would say, well, if you're a member, we don't consider you should be part of our union group, and we want to go through whatever the appropriate procedure. More importantly, you want to isolate them in the workplace, and so on. How far you can carry that depends, of course, but I think you have to draw a distinction. There is a big difference between somebody who's got all sorts of backward ideas, might even vote for backward ideas, racist ideas, and somebody who's an organised Nazi. You do want to isolate that person as far as possible. Now, what that means in practice, you have to look at your union, your workplace, and talk it through. The question we raise, the question of committees. Now, I agree with what that person says, sharing out jobs. It doesn't always have to be formal. You know, they have a formal committee where this person has that job and that, but a committee can also just be you get in the habit, or whenever there's something to do, you get three or four people that you want to sit and talk it through, and you informally divide up some of the work. In some places you can have a formal committee where people have definite jobs. It doesn't always have to be at that level, even in a sort of small, weekly organised work. Because if you can get two or three workmates to share out some of the discussion, share out some of the thing, that's good. On email and Facebook, I agree with all of the caution people said, absolutely right, but it can also be useful. I mean, Lilina from Denmark sitting at the front was telling me last night how in this city in Denmark, they very effectively used a Facebook group to organise a protest in a network independent when the union leaders wouldn't do something. So these are useful tools, and we need to be sensible about how we use them. They're not a substitute for face-to-face discussion, but they can be extremely useful, provided we use them in the right way, and some degree of caution, but also imagination comes into it. I strongly agree with the thing about casework. You have to do it sometimes, get a full-time officer to do as much as possible. You want to be a union activist and a leader, not a union lawyer, as far as possible. Michael's point about having a plan, absolutely, you need to have some kind of plan. And both in your workplace, Ian suggested a very good little technique to be having a conversation with a few people. Start by getting a few people to sit around and draw a map of your workplace. Which offices, which sections, which workshops there, who's in there, are they in the union? So you actually map the workplace, a plan, and that might suggest what you can do about building organisations. Simple things, having a plan about what to do. That applies very strongly if you've got a union branch in an area which is a bit dead and moribund. If everything goes through the branch secretary or the traditional activists who've got some facilities time, you've got to have a plan to do something about that. And all we are working in Tower Hamlets, we've got the NUT there. We had a plan, we had a big strike last year, so we thought, well, this can't be done anyway, we've got to have it. So we got a big committee of 11, 12 people, and we just said, if you're on the committee, you have to take responsibility for 7 schools around where you work. There's the list, there's the phone numbers, get on with it, you've got to organise the meetings, go in and do them. If you're working full-time, well, tough, you've got to do it in lunchtime or after work. You'd have to demand some commitment for people. It's not impossible if you do these things. You have to have a plan about how to go about doing things like that. Politics, absolutely. If you just talk about bread and butter issues, you won't deliver it. And again, I'll give you my own. The things that have been the biggest difference in building union organisation in my workplace in the last 2 years, I can list them straight off the top of my head. When I took a petition round in support of the students who were protesting, and then on the back of that, had a union meeting where we said, when the next time the students are protesting, we want 2 people from school released to go and join the protest with our banners. We approached the head saying, we want this. Actually, had agreed with us, two of us were able to go and join the student demonstration with our band. That changed the atmosphere in the work, made it more political. The next thing, when the BNP was standing in Barkingham Dagenham in the general election, we raised that and said, come on, at the weekend, some of us are going to go and leaflet and that. And we took four or five people to leaflet. So bringing those political issues changes the atmosphere in the workplace. In terms of issues to raise, I think the simplest thing to do, if you get socialist worker every week, every single week there is something in there that you can find as a peg to take into the workplace. So I know, for example, next Thursday, there's a school, Noel Park, in northwest London, which will be on strike against forced academisation, being privatised, essentially, certainly in education, but possibly wider than that. Going around your workplace this week saying, I've read about that story, I want to send a message of support from some of us in this workplace. Will you sign that? Send it off. That's an immediate issue. There'll be 100 issues every week. You can find something in socialist work, whether it's a political issue or a solidarity issue or something, which you can raise in work. So there's no shortage of things. Very fine point, I agree with the point that we need to have an argument or a discussion with all sorts of people, especially younger comrades. The workplace is central for the reasons I outlined, against the key to the transformation of society we have to, where the power lies and so on. But it's an argument we have to carry in a political way to a whole new young generation of comrades who are coming around, that they're going to use their energy, their politics, their dynamism, and those of us who've got some experience in workplace need to share that experience with them, not to do it for them, not to lecture them and tell them what to do, but to help them to grow themselves and discover how to be effective as radical, young, revolutionary workplace activists for their generation and build towards the future. That's our job as older comrades, is to help those younger comrades develop that.